Hey guys, welcome back to Weld.com. So today we have a very special guest in with us today, Mr. Adam Booth, or A-Bomb79, as he's better known from his YouTube and Instagram channels. He's come down to do a little bit of welding with us. He was in town anyway, checking out the beaches, so we decided to do a little bit of a collaboration. So we kind of want to find a rod big enough for A-Bomb. So that's exactly what we've done. We have the 3/4 inch Cormet F25 electrode we're going to use on some 3/4 inch plates. We've ran this test before, but we wanted to expand on it a little bit because everybody in the comment section wanted to see a cut and etch. So that's exactly what we're going to do. Adam's going to run this rod. We're going to be running about 1,000 amps, thanks to ReadyArc for getting us sorted out with the DC1000 as well as the generator. So we're going to run 1,000 amps on a 3/4 inch plate. Once we get done, we'll go ahead and do a cut and etch and check the depth of penetration on this thing. Now, as we said before, this rod is typically used in foundries. So they have the big molds and casings and the crucibles that, you know, they get cracked or worn out. They actually go in with this rod and they weld the areas that need repair, and then they can machine it back out or just leave it, whatever the case may be. But that's typically what this rod is used for. It's only good in the flat position. So that's why we're going to run in a regular 3/4 inch butt joint here. If you were to try to do this in the horizontal, it just wouldn't work. This puddle is way too fluid. You'll kind of see that once you get behind the lens, how fluid that puddle is, and just you really just have to hold it in place. So just kind of act like a tripod. I'm sure Adam will be able to take care of that for us. So
I'll give it my best shot. I'm actually looking forward to this because the largest electrode I've ever run is a 532nd 7018. I've run a lot of 7024s also. So it might be just like a supersized 7024.
It's very similar to a supersized 7024.
Yeah, this is really cool though. So I'm looking forward to trying it, man.
Let's go ahead and get into it.
All right.
So as we previously stated, we're gonna be running off this DC1000 here, donated or sent to us by ReadyArc. So thank you guys for pulling the strings and getting this stuff to us. We really appreciate it. We're gonna be drawing about 115 amps. Now we don't have that capacity for three phase 460 in our building. So let's go ahead and check out the power source for the power source. All right, so we're here in front of the Power Pro 150. This is actually the power source we're going to use to run the DC1000 to be able to do the welding that we're going to do. Typically, you're going to find these out in the field. You can hook up multi-banks of welders to these. So a lot of times they'll just have a whole six pack or more hooked up to one of these bad boys to be able to power the entire job site. Today, we're just going to use it for one welding machine. All right, so right now we're hitting just over 1,000 amps, almost 1,100. You're just gonna use a regular drag technique, very similar to a 7024. You can see it as a super fluid puddle. I'm really interested to see what type of deposition we got on here. Now it is extremely hot, so he's probably gonna run about half the plate, and then we'll stop, we'll let it cool down. We're gonna do a cut and etch. I wanna see what this penetration profile looks like. We have two 500 amp rated ground clamps hooked up to this, or workpiece clamps, hooked up to the material, because we're running those right off the same machine. You just can't run 1,000 amps off one cable. Same thing with the makeshift stinger. We got two 500 amp cables running to that. It's almost up to the point, but you can see how fluid that puddle is, and that's exactly why you're only gonna be able to run this in a flat position. You're not getting out of position with this thing anyway, but you wouldn't be able to run like a horizontal T-joint with this either, because the puddle is super fluid. You'd never be able to maintain that vertical leg on the piece. Like I said, it is a mechanized process and we're running it manually. So we're gonna have to take that into consideration as far as weld quality once we're done. But overall, I mean, this stuff runs pretty smooth. It's very fluid.
You can actually see the spatter coming off this thing. It's the size of small shooter marbles. This stuff's pretty intense. And like I said, the heat coming off of it is just extreme. We've got three fume extractors coming on here to pull off the amount of fume that it's generating. And it's probably still not adequate enough.
I want to say thanks again to ReadyArc for loaning us this DC1000 as well as a generator to power it. Make sure you guys visit ReadyArc for all your rental needs.
Man, I can't wait to dig into this and see what the penetration profile looks like on this. I bet it goes halfway, 3/4 through.
Man, that's hot. Look how sweet that is. You can feel the UV off that one. I was trying to get a little bit extra rod in there. I was having too much fun.
So you came down here go work on your tan lines at the beach. You didn't think you'd be able to do it here in the shop.
Nah.
Look, the concrete's glowing underneath.
Wow. The I could tell when I first started, we were just like blowing through. It was there wasn't enough material there at the very end of the plate to support it.
It kind of poured off the end just a little bit.
But as I got into there, you know, it started flowing a pretty decent puddle there.
What'd it feel like holding all that?
It's just, it's crazy, man. Like it's a total different feeling to me having to hold a rod like this with, you know, two arms the way I am. It's kind of like you said, it's like holding a minigun.
Yeah.
That's what it feels like, you're holding a minigun.
But yeah, it's a little awkward, but it's a neat experience.
It's a little bit on your back because you got to, you know, where it's positioned at down here, you just got to kind of hold it. So it's an interesting experience though.
Now we got to find a chipping hammer big enough to knock all that slag off. We'll get it cleaned up. I think we let it cool down just for a little bit. We might even quench it because we're not doing a bend test on it.
Yeah.
But we'll get it cooled down enough. We'll cut, you know, do a flame cut probably halfway, three quarter of the way through.
Yeah, somewhere
and
in
then,
here.
Yeah, and then we'll just, what we'll do is we'll cut that with the oxy fuel, clean it up with a couple different types of grinding discs.
Yeah.
And just to kind of polish that, bring it to closely to a mirror finish.
Yeah.
And then we'll hit it with, I think we have 5% ferric acid or ferric acid. And it'll just kind of bring out that weld nugget. You'll be able to see the dissimilarities between the weld nugget and the base metal.
All right, cool. So we'll be able to see, you know, what kind of penetration I got on that right there.
I'm thinking it's, I mean, that's 3/4 inch plate, probably 1/2 inch to 3/4 of the way through the plate, if not all the way. Like, I mean, as soon as you got done, you could see the glowing reflection off the concrete.
Yeah.
So you could tell, I mean, the heat's definitely getting into it.
Yeah.
And the whole time you were going, I think you were hitting right around 1100 amps.
No kidding.
Yeah.
So that's the highest amperage I've ever run on anything.
Oh, for sure.
All right, we'll go cut it and do our acid etch on it.
Yeah, let's get cleaned up.
All right, I'm going to go ahead and chip the flux off of it and get a look at our bead here.
See what's under the hood. Almost need a pickaxe.
That's right. This would be a good one for a needle scaler, too.
Oh, for sure.
But we'll get it all cleaned off. I've never seen do that before right there. It's almost like little pockets.
And it, I mean, that's kind of like because of how fluid that puddle actually is, I think, is because it's just so liquid, you can't control it. Whereas like with 7018, 7024, you got a thicker slag coverage.
Okay.
So it's easier to maintain a good, clean bead appearance.
Okay.
But with this stuff, I don't think it really matters. When they're welding up the big slag pots, I don't think they care about looks as long as it's going to hold and resist.
Yep. This kind of stuff isn't going to be out there on Instagram for the prettiest welds out there.
Oh, no, definitely. These are hashtag real welds.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, we'll get it all cleaned up, quenched, cut it, polished up, and check out that depth of penetration in there. That's really what I wanted to see. I know we had a lot of comments when we previously did this. They wanted to see an acid etch on it, so I think we'll give that to the fans.
All right, cool.
All right, so you see when I was cutting there, it kind of blew back a little bit. We've got like a little slag pocket, or not slag pocket, but like a large porosity pocket right in there. So as I was cutting through, it almost snuffed it out. So I went ahead, changed direction, cut from the other side right into it, and it just kind of released almost like trapped gas that was in there.
Yeah, okay.
So it's a very unique process. And like I said, I don't know how much detail they go into to do any post-weld cleanup other than chip the slag out and then, you know, throw the slag pot back in there for back into production. But we'll go ahead, I want to quench this now, and then we'll go ahead and clean it up and we'll acid etch it and just
see
check
how bad,
out that check out that nugget.
See how bad I did.
No.
So what's your process on what we're going to do here with your acid etch?
So anytime we want to do an etch, we just want to bisect the weld. So we're just going to cut the material. You can flame cut it, you can put it in the saw, doesn't matter as long as you cut it. Now we're going to go through a process of cleaning and prepping it up. So I'm going to take this Victor grain, this thing just eats material. I'm going to clean this up, kind of get it down rough, get the bulk of the cut striations out of there, hit it up with a regular flapper wheel, clean that up, and then finally take it down to almost close to a mirror polish Once we get to that stage, we'll actually be able to use some of this 10% ferric chloride, and we'll put some of that on there with Q-tips, and it'll expose the weld nugget, and you'll be able to see the dissimilarities between the two metals. You'll be able to see the depth of penetration, the width, all that good stuff. So
okay.
We just gotta get it to close to a mirror finish. The closer we get it to a mirror finish, the better off the results are gonna be.
Right, okay. I was just seeing which one you got here. So you got a 60 grit flap disc there, and then this is the one that's got the Scotch-Brite.
Yeah, it's got, so this one right here, you can actually take this if you're doing detail work. You can take it pretty much from weld to paint in one step, so you only need to use that wheel.
Okay.
And then this one right here, it's like I said, just we've beveled tons of plates with it, taking backing strips off material. I mean, they seem to last a lot longer. The great thing about them is as you're grinding, when the abrasive breaks, it breaks into another diamond shape.
Okay.
So it's just layers and layers of little diamonds on the inside, and it just continuously cuts until you completely wear it out.
Yeah, that's cool. I've never seen those before. It's a lot thinner than your typical abrasive.
Right,
steel grinder.
So it gives you a little bit of flex to it as well.
Yeah. All right, cool. Yep, I can see it.
So not as deep as I thought it was going to be. I mean, that's still pretty impressive because it's 3/4 inch plate. And
well, yeah, just measured from the back.
You can actually see good about 3/8. You're about 3/8 penetration in there. So it starts right there, follows all the way down,
mm-hmm.
right up into there, and you can actually see where the two plates originally butted up.
So we got about halfway through the...
About halfway into the plate.
So about, it was about 3/8.
Yeah.
About halfway there.
Without any joint preparation whatsoever, so it was just a square butt plate. So you got 3/8 depth of fusion, depth of penetration.
That's interesting. I'm a little disappointed in my, you know, inclusions there, the little holidays.
I think for running a process, you know, manually that's meant to be done mechanized, that's not bad at all. I mean, this process isn't meant to do what we did with it, but it's cool to be able to mess around with it. I mean, how often can you say, yeah, I ran 3/4 inch welding rod?
That's probably going to be the only time I ever run a 3/4 welding rod because it's not like it's very practical
yeah,
in
it's
the
not.
Everyday world.
If you, get a small repair around the shop, you know, you're not going to bust out the old DC 1000.
No, we might use a 1/8 70/18 or a 5/32 at the most.
But. Yeah, and then to do some basic joint preparation, I mean, you could, no problem, do a full pen weld on it.
Yeah, I think maybe if you want to try that again, you know, down the road, you know, for you guys, maybe try a V-joint there and see if you can get full penetration on a 3/4 plate.
Rod's probably 1 1/4 inch OD with the flux and everything on it. So probably stick around 1 1/8 inch wide opening. Get a 1 inch thick backing bar on there. But yeah, that'd be kind of neat to mess around with.
That might be something to try later. Well, it's definitely fun. Really interesting seeing the acid etch process there too.
Yeah, man. We appreciate you taking the time out of your day to come down and visit us, check out the shop, and burn a little rod with us.
It's been fun. I really have enjoyed coming down, and I was love seeing the shop here and all the awesome equipment that you got and being able to burn this rod. I loved whatever you said. We might put one of those 3/4 rods in your hand and let you burn that. I was like, I'm in. Let's do it.
It's literally a once-in-a-lifetime, well, twice-in-a-lifetime opportunity now. But, yeah, I mean, it's not something you do every day. It's not something you ever see outside of, you know, what we typically do on a regular basis. So it's cool to, you know, kind of experience some of those processes without – having to go seek a new career opportunity. So it's nice to, and then the exposure and stuff. So it's pretty cool.
Very cool, man. I've had a lot of fun today.
Well, thanks for coming out, man. Safe travels on your way back.
Thanks for having me. And maybe you can send some of those coupons.
For sure.
The weld test coupons with me. And we'll just do another video on that. I'll do some welding on those and ship them down here to you. You can test them for me.
Yeah, we'll get them all cut up and tested and all that.
All right, that sounds good.
Let you know how that goes.
All right.
Make you watch the video first.
I will. I'll check it out.
All right, guys. Well, hope you guys enjoyed the video. Thanks for watching. Hopefully that answers a lot of questions that you guys had about depth of penetration and doing a cut and etch using a 1,000-amp rod. So appreciate you guys watching. Thanks for subscribing. And until next time, make every weld better than your last.